Simon & Schuster Audio presents World of Warcraft, Stormrage, by Richard A. Knaak. Read by Richard Ferrone.
Prologue. Blood Quest. Thora stood at the end of the great jagged chasm. The young orc's powerful hand instinctively tightened on the axe as she sought in vain a way across. Thick and muscular of limb and torso, the orc was a skilled fighter despite barely being of adult years. Yet now her broad, rough-hewn features twisted into something more childlike, more fearful as she ran back and forth without success in her search. Her wide, tusked mouth frowned. Thora shook her head and murmured a wordless protest. Her heavy brown mane of hair, generally bound in a tail but at the moment set loose, spilled over the left side of her face. On the other side, a tremendous battle took place, the focus of it a single brawny male of her race and someone she knew mostly from childhood memories and tales spoken by the great orc ruler, Thrall. Facing her was a graying warrior with a stern visage and powerful arms. Like her, he was clad in the leather kilts and harnesses of a fighter. His body was covered in old scars from other battles, other wars. Even though surrounded, the male bellowed his contempt for his monstrous foes. And monstrous they were indeed, for they were demons of the Burning Legion, fell creatures far taller than the brave lone warrior. They were armored and burning from head to foot with virulent yellow-green fire whose intensity vied with the fierce determination in the brown orbs of the single orc. With wicked blades and other vile weapons, they slashed again and again, seeking to break through his guard. But ever he kept them at bay with his axe, a stunning weapon that was made more fantastic in that it was carved of wood. No, not carved. Thora recalled that a shaman had once inspected it and declared that great magic had shaped the twin-edged axe into being. Magic rumored to be that of the demigod Cenarius. Cenarius had been a keeper of nature, a protector of the forest. Whatever the amazing origin of the axe, though, it clearly had magic of its own, for it sliced through strong blades and thick armor with the ease of passing through air. Great flashes of sinister yellow-green fire sparked from the deadly wounds inflicted on them as they fell one after another to the orc's sure hand. A deep, almost hazy emerald aura that had nothing to do with the flames of the Burning Legion draped over all, even the solitary champion. The aura itself was touched by a slight blue hue that added a sense of surrealism to the moment. Thora paid little mind to the aura, though, her anxiety rising as she continued to fail to find a crossing. Then a new arresting figure materialized just behind and to the left of the male orc. He was an astounding being whose tall violet-skinned race was known to Thora, a night elf. Yet this was no ordinary representative of that people, for thrusting from his head were a pair of mighty and elaborate antlers. Moreover, he was clad in a striking outfit that marked him not only as a druid, one of the revered keepers of nature, but clearly one of high standing, perhaps even an archdruid. The night elf had a broader, more mature visage that gave him more individuality. He also wore a thick green beard. His glowing golden eyes, almost as arresting as his antlers, were plainly visible even from far away. The coming of the night elf caught Thora's breath. Unarmed, he leaned close to the male orc to whisper something, and his very presence seemed to assure the battling champion. Already the victor over many demons by himself, the older orc looked confident that he and the night elf would surely be able to stand against the bloodthirsty throng still converging on the spot. Behind the orc, the night elf's hands suddenly filled with a long wooden staff. He raised the staff high, and as he did, the closest end suddenly sharpened to a wicked point. In front of him, the orc slashed at yet another impetuous demon, slicing off its long, narrow head, curled horns and all. The night elf touched the point of the staff in the back of the male orc's neck. Thora saw too late the duplicity. She shouted in vain, her words smothered by distance and the clash of arms. From the back of the male's neck there burst a small growth. It resembled a weed such as Thora might have trod upon 1,000 times a day. Yet that weed sprouted rapidly, growing and growing within a single heartbeat. The other orc finally sensed it. He reached back, but several dark green leaves wrapped around his wrist. The weed continued to spread, pouring over the hapless warrior's body. As it did, the leaves began sprouting terrible thorns, all pointed inward. They jabbed into the orc, and wherever they did, they drew blood. With a smile, the duplicitous night elf stepped back to admire his handiwork. Rivers of blood poured from every thorn. The male orc shivered. His mouth gaped and he fell to one knee. The weed's tendrils covered his body until they completely bound him. Blood continued to gush from the monstrous wounds as the night elf watched with amusement. Thora called out the male's name, even though it was already too late to save him.
Broxagar!
Suddenly, the demons faded to mist. There was only the night elf, his victim, and Thora. The night elf stepped back farther, his mocking gaze turning to her. The golden orbs turned utterly black. They became deep pits that coldly pulled at the orc's soul. Then from those dark pits poured forth monstrous ebony carrion bugs. Beetles, millipedes, roaches, and more flowed forth from the night elf's eyes in horrific streams that spilled to the ground. The vermin spread in all directions, and as they did, trees and other flora materialized in their path. Yet the lush wildlife barely appeared before the vermin swarmed it. Bushes, shrubs, even the tallest trees became enveloped. And as they were, they withered. Everything withered. Thora's world became a twisted, hideous vision. The night elf laughed. From his mouth spilled forth more fiendish vermin. He vanished. Thora shouted out Broxagar's name again. With effort, the dying warrior managed to look her way. One hand broke free of the strangling weed, then stretched forth, the magical axe held out. His mouth whispered a name. Thora awoke with a start. She lay there for a time, still shivering despite the fact that the woods in which she currently traveled were of a comfortable temperature. The dream played over in her mind, just as it did whenever the orc wasn't reliving it in her sleep. With some effort, Thora finally rose. The small campfire that she had built earlier had long died out, only a few faint wisps of smoke left in memory. Momentarily setting down her weapon, Thora used some dirt to smother what remained of the fire, then looked around for her pack. Seizing up the small leather sack, she retrieved the axe and started off. It was always like this. Walking until she was dead on her feet, catching her supper, then sleeping until the dream woke her up and left her in such a state that she knew it was better to move on. In a macabre way, that suited the orc just fine. Not only was there risk of late for any who were merely sleeping, but each step took her closer to her goal, closer to avenging her blood kin. And even more, she had come to realize she was spurred on by another mission, to prevent a catastrophe that wouldn't only engulf her own people, but all else. The male orc, Broxagar, had been brother to her father, although their own fathers had been different. She knew of his legendary stand with his comrades against the Burning Legion, a stand which had resulted in Broxagar, or Brox, as the only survivor. Even as a child, Thora could sense the guilt he had felt at living when his friends hadn't. And then Thrall, the great orc leader, had sent the veteran warrior on a mysterious mission with another. Neither had ever returned, but then, as rumor had it, an old shaman had brought back the wondrous wooden axe from the dream and left it with Thrall. That shaman had also spoken of Brox becoming a hero who had helped to save not only the orcs, but all else. Some there were who said that the shaman had then sprouted wings and flown off into the night, transforming into a gigantic bird or dragon. Thora knew not whether all the last was true, only that when she had come of warrior age and proven her skills, Thrall himself had given her the fabled axe. She was, after all, the only left of Brock's.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.